Hello students, welcome to Abhipedia. Today our topic of discussion is how fiscal policy can be helpful in the economy. Now, I'm Alka Verma and I have a teaching experience of 22-23 years as a professor of economics. So I would like to simplify the concept so that you are able to understand what is fiscal policy. What are the objectives of fiscal policy and what are the tools, various tools of fiscal policy through which we can bring about a desired change in the economy. So now let's start. Fiscal policy is the policy that is related to taxation, public expenditure and public debt of the government. Now this word fiscal is derived from the word fisc. F-I-S-C, which means treasury. So fiscal policy is relating to the treasury and it is also known as budgetary policy. That means it is operated through the tools of the budget. So it is also called budgetary policy. Now there are certain objectives which we try to achieve through the fiscal policy. Now first one is that we want to achieve full employment. Every country aspires to achieve full employment. That means all the resources, they are fully employed. There is no wastage of resource. So for this, to achieve this objective, now how do we achieve it through fiscal policy? Now to achieve this, the level of public expenditure is increased. The level of taxes are decreased so that we have enough resources and that can be used by the government to spend the money, and this will increase the level of aggregate demand in the economy. And if it increases the level of aggregate demand, there will be naturally more investment. Investment will lead to more production, more employment in the economy. So this way, by making use of some of the tools of fiscal policy, that is public expenditure and taxation, so we can achieve the objective of full employment. This is first and foremost objective of a fiscal policy. Now, second important objective of a fiscal policy is price stability. We know that prices are subject to change. Every now and then prices are fluctuating. So, to achieve price stability, that is also one of the major objectives of fiscal policy. Now, how do we achieve price stability? All right. So there are various tools with the help of which we try to achieve the fiscal policy. In case of inflation, level of public expenditure is reduced. Taxation, that is level of progressive tax is increased so that people are left with less purchasing power. Less purchasing power will naturally bring down the demand, aggregate demand. And if the demand is less, automatically it will curtail the price and inflation can be checked to some extent. Similarly, if there is recession in the economy or depression in the economy, because economies, they are subject to business cycle. So we will have recession, we will have depression, we will have recovery, we are going to have inflation, that is expansion of the economy, or we call it boom of the economy. So in that case, when we have to bring about the price stability, how do we do it? So first, inflation, I have already told you. Now, supposing there is recession or depression in the economy. So, in that case, what will happen? Government, through the budget, of course, the public expenditure, that will be increased so that people are left with more money, more purchasing power. Then, taxes will also be reduced so that, again, people have left with more purchasing power, more aggregate demand. And this will lead to price stability during deflation. And so, this way, the second objective of monetary policy is fulfilled, that we try to achieve price stability. Now we have third objective, that is reduction in economic inequality. We know that we have extreme economic inequalities in our country. Some of the people are very rich, some of the people are very poor. So public fiscal policy is used to remove inequality. The government takes appropriate fiscal measures and tries to achieve this objective of reduction in economic inequality in the country. And the government, to achieve this objective, the government imposes progressive tax on the rich people, and on income tax, wealth tax, and incidence of these taxes, they are on the rich people, and whatever money is collected through the taxation, that can be utilized to transfer to the poor people by way of subsidies, by way of improving their lifestyle, so that the gap between the rich and the poor is bridged to some extent. So this is also one of the major objectives of fiscal policy. Now we move on to the third objective, that is economic development. I have already told you that every country is obsessed with economic growth and economic development. This is the biggest obsession of mankind. So fiscal policy helps us to increase the rate of capital formation so that we can have more economic development in a country. In underdeveloped countries, the rate of capital formation is very, very low. And we all know that capital formation is the sole determining factor that determines the rate of economic growth. So with the help of fiscal policy, we can go for economic development also. We can go for more public expenditure, and we can go for more infrastructure. We can go for more facilities to the poorer section of the society. We can provide more, health facilities, educational facilities, and this way it will lead to economic development. So basically, these are the four objectives of monetary policy. And these four objectives of monetary policy, they are pursued by some fiscal tools, which I am going to discuss with you. The fiscal tools, they are, you can see it here. There are four fiscal tools. First one is taxation policy. Second one is public expenditure. Third one is public debt. You can see it here. And the fourth one is deficit financing. All right. So these are the four tools of fiscal policy. First one is taxation policy. Second one is public expenditure policy. Third one is public debt or public borrowing policy. And the fourth one is deficit financing. So with the help of these tools, naturally we can bring about economic growth in the economy. So first I begin with taxation policy. Now, taxation policy, these are the main source of revenue for the government, and government gets its revenue through direct taxes such as income tax, wealth tax, corporate tax, and indirect taxes such as GST, value added tax, sales tax, excise duty. And main objectives of the taxation policy is, number one, to mobilize resources for economic development. So government, by imposing tax, mobilizes resources, all right, and these resources can be utilized for economic development of the country. Then secondly, taxation policy is pursued in such a way that it promotes saving, because underdeveloped economy, naturally we cannot do without saving, and the level of income is low in underdeveloped economy like India. So therefore, naturally the government gives deductions and concessions, and like if you save in provident fund, if you save in national saving certificates, then you get concession and deductions in your income tax returns also. So this way, through appropriate taxation policy, that is one of the important fiscal tool, the government tries to pursue and promote saving in the economy. And savings are very important, because in underdeveloped economy we have resource crunch. So with the help of savings, naturally we can have more resources, and more resources can be utilized for economic growth of the country. Then the third one is saving also helps in taxation policy also helps in investment, And so government wants to promote investment in backward regions, remote areas, rural areas. So various tax rebates, concessions, tax holidays, they are given so that there can be whatever inequality we have or regional disparity we have, that can be removed by pursuing appropriate taxation policy. Then to bring about equality of income and wealth in the economy, that is also another objective of the taxation policy. And so naturally high rate of income tax is levied and low rate of excise duty is levied so that it promotes more production. Then sometimes high rate of excise duty is levied on luxuries. So this way, by pursuing appropriate taxation policy, we can bring about economic growth in the economy. Then second instrument, you can see it on the board, that the second instrument of fiscal policy, that is our public expenditure policy. And public expenditure policy influences the economic activities of a country in a big way, in a great way. And public expenditure, they can be of two types. One is developmental expenditure and one is non-developmental expenditure. Non-developmental expenditure, they can be of many kinds. They bring about development in the economy. They help in getting more and more economic growth in the economy. They increase the productive capacity in the economy. All right. So, for example, extension of the means of transport and communication, then extension to the of the means of irrigation, completion of power projects, expansion of educational and health facilities. Always, all this can be done with the help of public expenditure. So public expenditure can be made in many ways. So first is development of public enterprise. In underdeveloped countries, there's lack of basic and heavy industries, and they involve huge capital, and that is not possible by the private sectors of the economy. So in that case, and besides that, these investments also involve a lot of risk. So private sectors, they're not ready to take these risks. So in that case, the government can develop this public enterprise and also provide employment opportunities to the people who are unemployed in the country. So this way, economic growth can be, we can get economic growth. Then, through public expenditure policy, the government can support the private sector by giving them subsidies, by giving them land at concessional rate, tax concession, etc. to the private sector. So government can support the private sector by pursuing appropriate expenditure policy. Then development of infrastructure, that is very important, because in underdeveloped economy like India, there's lack of basic infrastructure. So if we want economic growth and economic development in the country, we need to have proper infrastructure. And so it can be development of railways. So government can spend, public expenditure can be on a development of railways, means of transport and communications, hospitals, bridges, dams, tunnels, etc. So this way, there can be development of expenditure through appropriate expenditure policy. Then government also spends on social welfare. That is the third aspect of public expenditure. Government can spend on public health, education, safe drinking water, sanitation, welfare of the weaker sections of the society. And this way it can help in economic growth of the country. And non-development expenditure includes expenditure on administration, police, military, defense, law and order, collection of tax, interest on loans, payment of old age pensions. They are known as non-developmental expenditure because they do not raise the productive capacity of the country. But they are also important because we have to maintain law and order. So we need to have administration, we need to have police. So this way, these are the ways how public expenditure policy is pursued so that economic growth can be attained. The next one that we have is deficit financing. And it refers to financing of budgetary deficit. Budgetary deficits means excess of government expenditure on the income, on the revenue that we have. And deficit financing in India means taking loans from Reserve Bank of India, which is a central bank of our country. And Reserve Bank of India gives us loan by issuing new currency. And as a result, money supply increases and it may lead to inflation, and it has to be kept under safe limits. But during the recession, we need to have more deficit financing so that more money is injected into the economy and it increases the aggregate demand in the economy. More demand will lead to more investment, more production, more employment. And during inflation, the extent of deficit financing has to be checked. Otherwise, it may lead to high inflation rate in the economy. So anyway, deficit financing is also one of the important fiscal tools with the help of which we can achieve economic growth in the economy. And in India, naturally, it becomes very, very important because we need to increase the level of aggregate demand. So deficit financing can play a very, very important role. Now, another tool that we have is public debt policy. This is also known as public borrowing. Government needs a lot of funds for economic growth of the country. And no government can mobilize whatever funds are required through taxation. The reason being that in a country like India, many people do not come under taxation net, firstly. Secondly, people are poor, and if the rate of taxes are increased to get more revenue, then it may affect our saving and investment also. Taxable capacity is low. So in that case, government has to depend on public debt, and another name of public debt is public borrowing. So borrowing can be done in two ways. One is internal borrowing and the other one is external borrowing. In internal borrowing, government borrows within the country in the form of national saving certificates, Indira Vikas Patra, Kisan Vikas Patra, development bonds. So this way government borrows and utilizes it for the development of infrastructure, for the development of etc. Then besides that, we have external debt. External debt means government borrows from the other countries, government of other countries, or maybe from international organizations such as International Monetary Fund, World Bank, Asian Development Banks, etc. But they become more burdensome because the money that has been borrowed by the government has to repay it in foreign currency, so it becomes more burdensome. So these are the four tools: taxation policy, public expenditure policy, public borrowing policy or public debt policy, and deficit financing, through which the economy can achieve, bring about a desired change in the economy. Economy can achieve full employment, price stability, reduction of economic inequality, and also increase the level of economic growth in the country. Thank you. I hope you have understood the concept. And if you have liked the video, please share it. And please subscribe to Abhipedia. And next time, we'll come with more topics, better information. And it will help you for the preparation of your UPSC. Thank you very much.